Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody. My name is indeed Luc Middelburg. I'm from Delft University of Technology. And yeah, from the group of microelectronics, electronic components, technology, and materials. And today I'm going to talk about indeed the nonlinear bulk micromachined accelerometer for high sensitivity applications. So, what kind of applications can we think of in this regard? Well, one of the main applications is, for example, the measurement of the deviations in the gravitational force of the Earth. As you might know, the gravitational force of the Earth has some anomalies around the world which can be studied. And typically, the classical gravimeters used for this are quite bulky and costly because they consist of falling masses. And quite recently, there has been some MEMS implementations and designs for a MEMS, yeah, for an accelerometer instead of this this bulky gravimeter. And one inspiration for this work was actually the design done by Littlemiss of this MEMS application. And since we are considering accelerometers, there's typically a relation between the measurement range and the bandwidth. So typically because yeah, we're considering high sensitivity accelerometers, the resonant frequency in mass spring systems is typically low, and this low resonant frequency comes back with a high sensitivity, resulting in a low measurement range, because in a MEMS device we cannot allow for so much deflection as we would want. More applications are, for example, studying the ocean behavior of the tides, because the tides, they change the gravitational force slightly. Or also collect data for earthquake studies within the recent trend of IoT, of course. And another application could be oil or water pocket detection. Again, to stress the application of this, or the objective of this work, is to look into an accelerometer intended for slow varying signals. That means a low bandwidth, or at least low varying signals that mean the bandwidth in the order of a few hertz to up to 100 hertz. And as you can see from this picture on the right hand side, is that most of the gravitational information signals is below 1 hertz. And of course, another application could be a measurement of vibrations in industrial machines needing a very stable environment, as for example, a wafer stepper from ASML. So in terms of the system overview, regarding an accelerometer, of course, we go from the measurement we want to measure, the acceleration, and we go to the displacement regime, so the displacement domain, and we have a mechanical sensitivity there, defined by mainly omega squared, which is the resonant frequency. And in a relative open loop mass spring system based accelerometer, this is determined by the ratio of mass over stiffness. Then, of course, we have the transducer to the new domain, or the readout domain, which can be electrostatically, eddy current based, or optical. And then we have the sensitivity of the voltage. So the aim of this work is to maximize the mechanical sensitivity. And the reason for this is that we aim for a high system resolution. So the advantage is, if we are able to maximize sensitivity in the sensitivity from acceleration to displacement, then all the noise contributions later on in the work, or in the chain, in the measurement system, are scaled down, and the input referred resolution yields a better value. However, this is not coming free, of course, because if we have higher mechanical sensitivity, that also means that the bandwidth will be lower, which is typically, as a rule of thumb, half of the resonant frequency. And also in terms of mechanical sensitivity, this will be at cost of the rejection ratio of spurious nodes. So that means that the movement in unwanted directions of this accelerometer is also significantly more present. And on the right hand side, you can see in a measurement shown in literature where a MEMS gravimeter or accelerometer is compared with a commercially seismometer, and we can see that Indeed, the spectrum of interest is in the order of only a few hertz. So again, to show this work, so regarding the sensor system, this work mainly focuses on the design, the mechanical design of the accelerometer, while keeping in mind that we want to make the design in such a way that in the future we can integrate the readout transducer, so that can be electrostatic, optical, monolithically, so on wafer scale. So regarding the mechanical design, we aim for high sensitivity, that means a low stiffness and a large mass. First, considering the stiffness, well, that is mainly determined by the springs in the system, and these springs are considered, are actually long, thin beams. So this is on the right hand side, you see a 2D view, and yeah, these long standard beams are fixed on the left hand side. So at this point, the beam will be fixed, and on the right hand side, there will be only an allowable movement in the Y direction. And that means that the total length cannot really, it's bounded in the X direction, so to say. So if we prescribe a deflection in the Y direction, at a certain moment, we will see a nonlinear forward displacement behavior caused by an effect called buckling. This is quite a known mechanical effect. And thanks to this effect, we get an S-shaped-like curve in the beam itself. It's hard to see because the beam is quite thin in the simulation part. But as a result, we have a forward displacement graph, which looks like this. So normally you want a spring which is linear. It's obvious Hooke's law. But in this case, we want to have the spring to be have a spring softening effect in the center. So if we scale the mass in such a way that in our environmental conditions, the operating point is on this point in the flat region, then the first order derivative of this fourth displacement will be a very low value because the slope is nearly flat in this result, and thus we have a very low stiffness locally. So if we have larger movement from this operating point, then again we see that the stiffness is increasing, which has the advantage that if the shock is, for example, much larger than the dynamic range which is objected, then still the structure will not break down because the stiffness is increasing again. So again, regarding the mechanical design, as you have seen in the previous slide, is that we have a stiffness which is depending, is a function of the deflection. So that also means that if we assume a constant mass, that the resonant frequency is also a function of deflection. So we have to adapt all parameters very close together, that we have the operating point at the bias acceleration that we want. A die of 10 by 10 millimeter was assumed, and that also implies that we have some limitations regarding the lowest resonance frequency, which is actually the square root of k over m. But because we consider bulk micromachining, at a certain point we want to increase the mass to have an even lower resonant frequency. But because the thickness in bulk micromachining is defined by the thickness of the substrate, then we immediately have an area effect. So we want to have the mass even larger than a certain amount, having the same stiffness, then yeah, in the end we will not fit within a 10 by 10 millimeter. And then regarding the feasibility of the beam, so in the previous slide I showed you the concept of this nonlinear beam, and then the width of the beam, so this is actually the cross-section of the beam. We did some feasibility testing, so what is the smallest width of the beam that we can fabricate and that is still feasible? So for that we etched some test structures by a Bosch process, deep reactive ion etching, of beams ranging with the width ranging from 1 micron to around 100 micron, and we found that the beam width, which is smallest obtainable, is around 5 micrometer. So the design in total will be on the right hand side on the bottom. So we have 4 beams connected to a frame and a center mass. And yeah, as I mentioned, the beams, the smallest width of the beams is 5 micron, and the mass is maximally bounded by the area and also the fact that we want to fit in 10 by 10 die and use bulk micro machining for this. In terms of simulation, of course, the mechanical sensitivity is actually mainly determined by the resonant frequency at this bias point, so at this point of low stiffness, locally low stiffness. And by simulation, we were able to bring resonant frequency down to 2 Hz, which is especially quite low. So that means that in a system application, the resonant frequency or the operational bandwidth will range up to 1 Hz, which corresponds to this gravitational application. And of course, the parasitic movements and the mode shapes were also studied, and the stiffness in the X and Y direction is also simulated, because yeah, we want that the device is only sensitive in the direction designed. In terms of realization, the device was etched using a deep reactive ion etching. Of course, a hot mask was used with additional aluminum layer to prevent leakage of helium. And to perform the preliminary measurements or measurements of the mechanical part, we used packaging with gloss. So we were able to use optical setup later on. And we used this both with by wafer and by individual die. And in terms of measurement and characterization, an optical setup was designed, which is actually based on a single generator driving a shaker amplifier and a shaker. On this shaker, the entire wafer was mounted, as you can see in this picture. And it was mounted and aligned in such a way that the laser and the photodiode on the other side of the wafer are just in line with the edge of the mass. So a slight movement of the mass would change the intensity of the light on this photodiode. And in this setup, we are able to see the relative displacement of the mass compared to the wafer. So at the moment that the mass starts to resonate, then the displacement of the center mass is much larger than the movement of the wafer. And by this, we can see this in we can see an increase in the laser intensity on the photodiode. So simultaneously, we sampled in a real-time measurement both the signal coming from the single generator and the signal coming from the photodiode. And with the aid of MATLAB, we were able to say something about the transfer function. So again, we applied a mechanical excitation on the shaker ranging from 5 Hz to 15 Hz during a sweep time of 60 seconds. At the same time, we did sampling of the photodiode of around one kilo sample per second. And we see, if we see at the spectrum, two measurements were carried out on two different dies, that the resonant frequency is around 12.6 Hz. And this translates back to a mechanical sensitivity of 0.4 millimeter per meter per second squared, which is actually normalized to SE units. And the quality factor is based on 3 dB roll-off, and it's around is 12. And this can be explained by air film damping, because there hasn't been much research into the packaging scheme yet. So in terms of the conclusions, the mechanical part of the relative accelerometer was designed and realized. 4 long slender beams were integrated in a frame and proof mass to yield maximum mechanical sensitivity. An optical setup was designed for determination of the mechanical spectrum and the resonant frequency. We measured one resonant frequency at 12.6 Hz. A lower resonant frequency was measured by adding mass, for example, by glue. And the discrepancy can be explained by process variations and the fact that the stiffness of the beams are proportional with the third power of the width. Furthermore, the readout transducer is an ongoing project to be integrated on wafer level. And this can be optically or electrostatically. And I think the time is limited, so I will skip the movie. And then I would like to thank you for your attention. So this movie is about a different structure, because I mentioned the process variations, and this is actually a spiral resonator and some other resonating structures which can be etched through a wafer and measured in the clean room optically to see something about the process variation. So you can see that there's a spiral functioning as a spring and a center mass, and by looking at the sag of the center mass by focusing a microscope in the clean room, we can say something about beam width variation during re-etching. But this is just something to elaborate on this process dependency.
It's very interesting. I think we need to skip the questions. If anybody has a question, you know, can ask.
Of course. Board.